Can I get your attention, please? Welcome to the subcommittee of the Health and Human Services Committee. And before we begin, I'd like to ask Senator Setzler to open us in prayer. What's your mind?
Let's pray. Dear Heavenly Father, the giver of all good things, we just praise you and thank you for all that you're doing in our lives. We pray, Lord, that we would be mindful of the least of these, Lord, that you've called us to serve and be mindful of. Pray that we would humble ourselves before you, pray that you give us the wisdom that only you can give. Bless these proceedings today, that we would ask hard questions, that we would understand truth when we hear it, and seek to glorify you in all we do. We pray this in your holy name. Amen.
Thank you, Senator. So we have one bill on our agenda today, House Bill 520. It's for a hearing only. We're not voting on this bill today. The bill crossed over from the House just over a week ago, and time is short before the end of the session. We have committee members with multiple conflicts, and so we have a hard stop at 3 o'clock today. Because of that, we're gonna have the House sponsors present the bill, have questions from the committee, and then we'll take as much public testimony as we have time for. The hearing is being live streamed on the legislative website, and it's also visible on the TVs outside of the committee room. So with that, we're gonna have the bill presented, starting with Representative Jones, Sherman Jones, and Representative Oliver. Result number one. Witness one?
Yes.
Okay, the floor is yours.
Can you hear me? Okay, perfect. Thank you very much, Madam Chairwoman. Thank you, Madam Chairwoman. I appreciate that, and I appreciate the opportunity, as does Representative Oliver, to present House Bill 520 to you today. I am going to, for the purposes of the committee, I'm going to cover sections 3, 6, 10, 11, 14, 15, 16, 17, and the latter part of 19. Representative Oliver will come around on the remaining 20. Or not the remaining 20, but of the 20, she'll do the remainder, and then also the first part of 19. We wanted to start with these because these were the ones that, frankly, that we understand that you were hearing the most amount of questions about, and we felt as if we should hit those head on, as opposed to just going through it in a numerical order. We felt as if that would be helpful for the committee to basically understand exactly what the process was in terms of how we got here. Representative Oliver will go through a series of different, I'll say, ways that the information was put together, but ultimately, please know this, the Behavioral Health Commission, along with all of its subcommittee chairs, were absolutely critical and integral in terms of the development of House Bill 520. Moving on to Section 3 of House Bill 520, one of the things that you will see inside of this bill is of the 20 sections, 5 of them are literally studies in terms of 5 out of the 20, and Section 3 fills that slot very, very well. This was one that came out of Chief Justice Boggs' subcommittee, and it really focuses on serious mental illness and then also on familiar faces. The focus here is to be able to put together all of the stakeholders who are involved in this very critical group of people. Whether or not you own a business or whether or not you're just managing a family, the fact is you look for that one small piece of data or that one small group that is taking up a significant amount of your resources, and that is effectively your familiar faces. These are individuals that are known in the homeless community, they are known within the healthcare community, and they're also known within, unfortunately, the law enforcement, the incarceration, maybe the sheriff or maybe the DOC. It's absolutely imperative, since these individuals make up probably 1% of all the mental health patients we have in this state or less, that we get a hold of this, basically this crazy cycle they're on. And if you can think of a three-legged stool, they're going from homelessness to healthcare into incarceration, and they just keep going. They may make up 1% or less than 1% of our mental health community, but they take up an exorbitant amount of the resources. Hence, we've asked all the stakeholders, and you see that in Section 3, to get together and really finalize what do we see as a proper definition, and then how it is would be some of the ways that we could address that. Again, recommendations. Moving on to section six, this is another one of the five study sections. This is a bed study. We've been asked several times, why do we need a bed study? This is not just about counting beds. This is about understanding not just the number of beds inside of the state of Georgia, but also the types of beds. Are they inpatient? Are they outpatient? Are they acute? Are they extended care, etc.? And then equally important, you will see in there that we also need to know, are they in-state or out-of-state residents currently occupying those beds? One of the things that we find from this type of information is that we know that our reimbursement rates are so low compared to our neighboring states when it comes to Medicaid reimbursement that a lot of these for-profit entities are actually incented to take out-of-state cash-paying customers as opposed to a Georgia citizen. Sections 10 and 11 are effectively mirrors of each other, one regarding mental health and one regarding substance abuse. Effectively, one of the things that you all have been hearing about are, quote, the two affidavits. And the two affidavits declaring whether or not someone may have mental illness or whether or not they may have substance abuse issues. Let me be perfectly clear, that is existing law that has literally been there for decades. That is not new law, we are not treading new ground. That is something that has been there. People ask all the time, why not just a physician's order? Well, unfortunately here in the state of Georgia, not proud of this stat, but we have counties without doctors. I'll say that one more time, we have counties without doctors. The second type of person who's going to be helped by this is that individual, like the 17-year-old who came up to me at a town hall and said, my mom has the ability to, quote, stay straight when the police are there, and then she immediately devolves as soon as the police leave. Imagine that. We're expecting the police to witness it. They can't witness it, so they can't effectively start the process, but yet this 17-year-old has become effectively the adult of the house. So this is not an avenue that is taken often in current law. Typically, it is the physician's order that is taken. However, our feeling is that not only is that existing law, but what we wanted to do was attach the physician's order or the two affidavits to the judge's order. So keep in mind, the two affidavits go in front of a judge. That order then goes with the patient to the hospital. We, at that point, and you'll see in the new language, we ask that the affiant's names be redacted there. That is strictly from a public safety and from a public safety point of view. We do not want an individual who may be violent or who may be wanting to get some type of revenge after being put into that space to come after those individuals. Let me be clear. Those affidavits, along with the names and all the information on those affidavits, are part of the court record. They can be obviously opened up by the court. They can be opened up by proper, you know, lawyering in terms of getting that information. This is not information that suddenly is redacted forever, but rather it remains. Moving on to section 14 and 15. Surprised that the pushback on 14 and 15, because this is essentially the exact same language of 43-35-5.1. I'll say that reference one more time, 43-35-5.1, that went in 2010, including the entity language around immunity. In 2010, we put it in for the doctors. In 2023, what we're asking for is to put this in for mental health professionals and nurses. Effectively, from a workforce development standpoint, and I'll just use, and this is just an example, a 35-year-old nurse gets addicted to OxyContin. We would like that nurse to somehow stay in the workforce once they get rehab, not lose their license forever. This allows them to be able to go to the licensing board and basically admit that they are addicted. They probably get their license, if they do get their license, suspended, and then they go through rehab and they go through testing, et cetera, 90 days, 120 days, whatever is prescribed by the doctor, and then ultimately the entity will prescribe back to the licensing board a recommendation of whether or not they should get their license back or not. Let me be clear. 2 years from now, if that nurse does something wrong, or that nurse does, you know, in terms of at least an assumption of malpractice, all the information is absolutely discoverable inside of any type of court proceeding. Section 16 is another one that is regarding data sharing. I think it's imperative that we all understand that effectively our governor sits within the Constitution to be one of the most powerful governors within the entire United States from a constitutional standpoint. That's not an opinion of Mr. Kemp, but rather just what the Constitution gives in terms of authority and responsibility to the governor. Over the years, that responsibility has been split up into a myriad of different agencies. We all can basically say the alphabet soup names. What you'll see is there are databases within each one of those entities, but ultimately, There's an executive branch file cabinet, for lack of a better phrase, and there are folders within that file cabinet that represent each one of the agencies. What we want to be able to do is have those agencies share the data. I'll say that one more time. Share the data, but under federal law, state law, and then also the basically taking out PII, making sure that it's limited, making sure that's encrypted at rest, encrypted during transit, etc. So this by no means strikes any responsibility when it comes to the privacy, when it comes to cyber best practices, but rather it allows for us to have a function, and you will see in there that a director is appointed for the GDAC, and ultimately that individual will be the one that will determine if that data can be shared, and if it can be shared, it must go underneath all current federal and state laws. There's an appeals process in there to the Executive Council of the Governor. But ultimately, what we're trying to do here is this, everyone. We want to basically determine, is there a way to help? Can we help with the data that we have? We see businesses every day look at data and determine, is there a trend line that would be able to help the citizens of Georgia, and how can we be proactive? Section 17, and I'm almost done. I got Section 17, a latter part of 19. Section 17, there's been a significant amount of, I'll say, conjecture regarding Medicaid and what that is doing. I want to be clear. There is no expansion of the roles of Medicaid in any of those subsections. One more time. There's no expansion of the roles of Medicaid in any of those subsections. What it does, though, is you will see Section A, for instance, those individuals that would get those three existing diagnostic codes, they are already qualified for Medicaid and getting a series of services from Medicaid. However, those three diagnostic codes, we believe, will save the state a significant amount of money because they're diagnostic codes. If we have a better understanding of what that individual's challenge is, we can come up with a better treatment plan, and hopefully that individual is able to get better or at least get stabilized in a shorter amount of time, hence reducing the amount of resources that the state has to pay for that. You will then see further down in D, E, and F, I believe, or C, D, and E, you will see that is effectively moving that into the state plan. Right now it's in CMS, and then moving that into the state plan. That effectively calls for the state, already doing most of that work, to effectively do that work. But to be clear, it does not expand the roles. And then finally, Section 19, I'll take the second half of that, and I'll allow Representative Oliver to take the first half. The second half of that speaks to the repayment of loans. Let me be perfectly clear. We have a problem. I don't say that tongue in cheek. I don't say that as some type of, you know, political comment. But we literally have, just like we have counties without doctors, we have counties and communities without mental health professionals. We have counties and communities without substance abuse professionals. So how do we find a way to get these individuals into Lanier County, into Ware County, into Echols County? I can keep going. But I think it's imperative that we are able to say to ourselves, how can we do that? And I think it's important that we look at that in such a way that how can we as a state use our resources appropriately? This is not the paying off of student loans. If someone went to NYU and took on $250,000 of student loans, I would say to them, I don't think that was a good decision, but that's my own personal opinion, but this does not relieve them of that. Rather, it's $10,000 a year for up to 5 years if they remain in that underserved community. And to that point, to line 1021, I do believe that we either need to narrowly define underserved youth or we need to redact that completely. But after having more and more time with that, I don't believe that underserved youth, I think it's too broad, and I think we either need to take it out or we need to define it better. But the next line around underserved areas, I think, is well defined, and I wanted to make sure you know that. Finally, there was a colleague of mine who came to me on Thursday of last week, who I thought made a very good recommendation for the latter part of 19, and that's what I'm going to call the public good clause. And effectively what he said was, what we can do is help communities to better see, I'll say, the effects of mental health and substance abuse, and what could these individuals that the state has said, you know what, you're so important, we need you down there, is there a way through some type of best practice within their loan document, not to do anything other than say, given best practices, commercial best practices, what type of information could you provide to the community to help them understand what would be the, I'll say, first indicators or second indicators of mental health or substance abuse? Madam Chairwoman, that is the end of my comments.
Thank you, and I know you're going to have to leave, but we're going to go ahead, Representative Oliver, if you could cover the other sections, and then if you're willing to take all the questions, that'd be great.
Thank you, Madam Chair. I'm very happy to be here, and I appreciate the privilege of presenting another opportunity for the state to move forward on mental health reform. What is different this year than was presented to you in 1013? I'd like to take just a moment to talk about that. In 1013, we came to the General Assembly with a number of different recommendations that came from the Behavioral Health and Innovation Commission, chaired by Kevin Tanner.
Okay, Hank Sullivan.
The lead sponsor for the bill owns a company who stands to benefit from its passing. That is because he owns a monitoring company that does monitoring that is described in the bill. He had the same monitoring described in 1013 last year, and thankfully, for the hard work of the Senate, that monitoring aspect was removed. But he stands to gain from this. He and his partners stand to gain from this bill passing, and he's putting funding and he's putting grants in order to fund these different aspects of health.
Madam Chair, I wonder if that would be appropriate for his testimony to be when Chairman Jones is here. Sounds a little bit unfair.
Chairman Jones had the opportunity to be here.
Do you have line numbers in the bill
that you're referring to?
Then you should have stayed.
Start his time
yes.
again.
Yes.
You can
look at line numbers 551 through 558, 545 through 550. You're going to find that these line numbers deal with professional health care program, defining the professional health care program, and the fact that monitoring and rehabilitation of impaired health care professionals for the purpose of this, that, and the other thing. Impaired means the inability of a health care professional to practice and reasonably, with reasonable skill and safety to patients by reason of illness or use of alcohol, drugs, narcotics, and chemicals. What he's done is he's defined what his product does, which is a monitoring device. It monitors biometrics as well as GPS. So he's defined in the bill what his particular device actually does that's patented. And he's marketed this to Tennessee. It's in three states right now. It's now in Paulding County and in Fulton County. And I'd like for my entire remarks to go to the committee, if I could. All
right. Thank you. Thanks to everyone for coming down. Stay tuned. This is a long process. We're just the beginning of it. Thanks very much, Lord Jones.
I'm going to start the video.